Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people, a regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics, brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Parker.
Welcome to the silky smooth sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I'm your co-host, Scott Parkin, in Berkeley, California. And as always, I am joined by...
From just down the street from you today in Oakland, California, Bob Bazanko. And as always, we begin by thanking everybody who listens and watches and ask that you continue to support us. And the easiest way to do that is just to share these episodes, no matter what. You know, you can email them to friends, you can tell friends about them. We're on all kinds of social media. We have postcards. If you want some, we could send them to you. Please subscribe to us on YouTube or your favorite podcast platform, and rate, review, and leave comments. Comments will be great. We need more comments. And so there's all kinds of stuff you can do just to help us get the word out, because we have really awesome guests, and today's show is going to be another one. We've been on a roll lately with Mike Foley talking about Johnny Cash, and we have Alex Vital talking about policing, and we have another fantastic show today about a really timely topic. So please share and spread the word. And if you really like us,
you can donate. It's the end of the year. It's a good time to support your favorite grassroots scrappy podcast, Green and Red Podcast. Check us out at greenandredpodcast.org and hit that support button for a one-time donation. Or you can become a patron at patreon.com/greenandredpodcast. And for today's show, we are going to be talking about the case of Chevron and the humanitarian and environmental disaster which they have perpetrated. Not just disaster, but like war crime or ecological crime. I guess war crime is not too far away, but it's just this complete disaster and crime against humanity in which they've perpetrated in Ecuador. We're going to be talking to, and then lots of things that have come out of that, including we'll be discussing a little bit the case of lawyer Steven Donziger, who challenged Chevron for a long time and has ended up being under house arrest and doing some jail time as a result of fighting Chevron for a long time. But we're going to be talking with Paz Aminio, who is the associate director of Amazon Watch, who has overseen the Chevron Ecuador campaign since 2008. He's been a professional human rights, corporate accountability, and environmental justice advocate for over 25 years. He has been a Colombia country specialist for Amnesty International US since 1995. He's been on the staff of Human Rights Watch in the Americas and was the Guatemala Chiapas program director at the SEVA Foundation for 7 years. Paul has lived in Chiapas, Mexico, and Quito, Ecuador, promoting human rights and community development. Paul, welcome to the Green and Red podcast.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah. And so, you know, talking a little bit about the crimes that Chevron has perpetrated in Ecuador, maybe just kind of, could you start off a little bit with what they actually have done and what Texaco, which is another big oil company that they bought in like the early 2000s, what they had done, how Chevron is connected to that?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. So Texaco was the very first oil company to drill for oil in the Amazon anywhere. In 1964, they signed a consortium agreement with the very US and oil-friendly government of Ecuador to explore oil fields in the northern Ecuadorian Amazon close to the border of Colombia, called Oriente. Texaco obviously had already existed for many years as a corporation and was one of the largest oil companies in the US. They knew how to operate oil fields, right? This was not a new company in Ecuador that didn't know what they were doing, which makes what they did even more disgusting, because they decided intentionally to pollute for decades as a cost-saving measure, because they knew there were no government regulations or authorities that were going to force them to behave otherwise. They made a calculation that while drilling for oil, when they extracted what's called foundation waters, which are laced with carcinogens and other metals and horrible toxins, the process by law in the US and elsewhere was those foundation waters need to be put into storage tanks and then re-injected into the earth. And this is the heart of the crime at hand. Texaco decided they didn't want to build tanks. They didn't want to re-inject. And they could save about $3 a barrel if they simply dumped all of that toxic waste into the rainforest. So they dug pits into the earth. They didn't even put a lining in them to prevent the chemicals from going into the groundwater. They designed a system of gooseneck pipes to have the runoff go out because it rains every day, and the water is heavier than the foundation waters. It would travel through the toxins, carrying them into the local waterways. And so they ended up leaving 916 of these pits and dumping at least 16 billion gallons of toxic waste between 1964 and 1992 while they were the sole operator of these fields. The real number is probably closer to 100 billion gallons of toxic waste. 16 billion is just what they admit to deliberately doing. And wrap your mind around that for a second, right? They admitted to deliberately poisoning the drinking water of indigenous peoples and others over the course of decades, and to doing it as a cost-saving measure in full view of the Ecuadorian government at the time. And then when their consortium ended, they took their money and left the country, leaving that waste there for the people of Ecuador to clean up. And that was just chapter one, which, you know, dragged on obviously for a long time. Meanwhile, people were getting sick and dying, and indigenous peoples were told the oil was good for their skin. They would spray it on the road to keep the dust down while these people were walking back and forth over this land. And so it turned this area of Ecuador into what's been called a rainforest Chernobyl.
Yeah, I mean, it's mind-boggling. And it's mind-boggling that, well, it's mind-boggling that we live in a world where they get away with this. I'll say that I'm also, like, you know, have some experience and some full knowledge that, you know, that there's been this sort of like complex series of campaigns that has been launched to sort of, you know, get some justice for people in Ecuador, for these indigenous communities, et cetera. And Chevron has responded in kind to that campaign. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about some of the different steps in campaign. I know in the early 90s that there was like a legal case that was launched. I know that about a decade ago, there was like, you know, nonprofits, including Amazon Watch, which began a sort of like branding brand jamming sort of, you know, mm-hmm. get some restitution out of Chevron, et cetera, campaign. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about some of the campaigns against Chevron in this, and maybe even prior to Chevron taking over Texaco, there were campaigns as well.
Yeah, and what's important also to note about what I mentioned before is that, you know, we're talking about many hundreds of times more gallons of toxic chemicals than even the Deepwater Horizon spill, right? If Texaco had started to clean up the day that they stopped operating, they would have to have cleaned up 4 million gallons a day, and they would only have just finished. If that means, you know, back in 93, imagine that, right? So the scope of this, and what you said about, you know, it's amazing that people are able to do it. No one had ever committed this kind of environmental crime before or even since. It still remains the largest and worst oil-related crime in history. The shocking thing is that it's not common knowledge. And that's where we get into the next stage, right? And what happened. So because it's Ecuador, Texaco figures they weren't gonna ever have to pay to clean up, but they went to the government of Ecuador in 93 after they realized that people were going to come after them in some shape. And they signed a $40 million extremely corrupt agreement with the government of Ecuador at the time to say, we're gonna give you $40 million and conduct a remediation of a portion of these waste pits. And in return, the government of Ecuador said, we're not gonna pursue legal action against Texaco. And Texaco thought, okay, we're off the hook now. $40 million is chump change. They'd extracted billions of dollars. And so what they did was they pushed dirt over a portion of those pits and called it clean. They certified it. They helped told people to go live there. They planted some trees on it. And people did go live there. And many of them got sick and died. But then Texaco thought, we're done. They went back to the United States. And the next step was that indigenous communities banded together with lawyers like Steven Donziger, who's one of them you mentioned, and they brought a class action lawsuit against Texaco in New York, where their headquarters was. The agreement that Texaco signed with the government of Ecuador specifically said that it did not protect them from civil action. It was only the government that wasn't going to go after Texaco, but this is the people that it harmed going after them. Right. No group of indigenous peoples had ever sued an oil company, a multinational oil company, before. So this was this historic event that it even happened. So they went to New York, and they went to the Southern District of New York. Remember that because it's really important. It plays a big role later in this saga, right? And after 8 years of petitioning essentially to achieve justice in the United States, the home of the oil company that had committed and admitted horrific crime, that court system said, no, you can't bring your case here, and sent them back to Ecuador. Now, interestingly, Texaco lost the first round of that, and then they appealed. And the Court of Appeals in the Southern District of New York then sided with Texaco. And the conditions upon their appeal were, Texaco said, Your Honors, if you agree with us that the United States should not be the proper venue, if this case is heard in Ecuador, we will abide by whatever decision the Ecuadorian justice system comes up with and respect it. That was the condition upon which they said it should go back to Ecuador. So obviously this was a really tough thing for the Ecuadorian people. They'd already been waiting 8 years. The case goes back to Ecuador. That's when Chevron merged with Texaco. So Chevron absorbed Texaco. And Amazon Watch was at the shareholder meeting prior to that happening, warning the CEO and the board of Chevron that if they bought Texaco, they were going to be buying this massive environmental liability in Ecuador, unlike anything that had ever happened before. And they should either stop the merger or say they weren't going to go ahead unless Texaco first cleaned up. Of course, they ignored us and they ignored the indigenous people, and they went ahead and merged. So the first day of the trial in Ecuador, Chevron's lawyers stood up. Jones Day, by the way, were the lawyers that they had hired, stood up and said, we shouldn't be here. We don't recognize this. We never operated here. That was Texaco, not us. And they tried to derail the entire thing after arguing for 8 years that it should be there.
That was Trump's, one of Trump's law firms last year, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's why I mentioned Jones Day. They're one of the, they're not the most evil law firm that plays out in this. Gibson Crutcher is the worst. But the point is, Texaco and then Chevron never for a single moment intended to respect the rule of law. Of course, they deliberately committed a crime in the first place. They admitted to doing it. This wasn't like people saying, hey, we want to defend our rights. We want to have a judge decide what should be done. We recognize things happened and we'll make it right. It was, we got to stop this from happening. So they stopped it in the US, and then in Ecuador, 8 more years go by, and Chevron the entire time is trying to stop the trial from happening in Ecuador. We could spend an entire podcast just going through all the dirty tricks that Chevron tried to prevent the trial from going forward. And in Ecuador, it's insane because every 2 years, the judge had to be replaced according to Ecuadorian law. So, and there had never been a case like this before. So imagine all of the information and everything involved in a case of this size. And then after 2 years, sorry, I'm out here, tag in the next judge who has to start all over again. And every time a new judge would come, Chevron would object to the judge. They would file motions saying they shouldn't be the one on the case, or they did something wrong, or the other side did something wrong. And every time a motion is filed, the trial would stop. The judge would have to see the motion, send it back to Quito to the higher court to make a decision, get a response. Months would go by. Okay, now we can start again, and Chevron would file another motion. At one point, they filed 40 motions within a couple of days. So this was all their tactic to delay and derail the case, right? This, again—
And their objection in reality is not just with each judge, et cetera. It's with the fact the case exists at all.
Exactly, and every little thing around surrounding it. Remember this entire time, indigenous communities and other communities there are living with the waste, and they're having to keep this legal battle going the entire time. At this point, it's been decades, right? Chevron's calculation was they'll eventually go away. They'll run out of money. They'll run out of supporters. They'll literally die from the contamination. And eventually we won't have this problem. And in the meantime, our lawyers will get some money. And these law firms like Gibson Dunn have basically built their entire practice on the reputation they got and the work that they put in and the money they got from Chevron at that point. So the point is, despite all of those insurmountable odds, they won. Indigenous communities and farmer communities successfully sued one of the biggest, most powerful oil companies in the world. And in 2011, February 14th, they won what was at that point an $18 billion judgment. Nothing like that had ever happened before. Was
Correa president by then?
Yes.
So is that important in this? Like the, just the
it kind plays, of, yeah. It plays, I'm pretty sure he was by then, yes. If not, he was just about to be, but I'm pretty sure.
My instinct is he was.
He was, yeah that's right.
Because I mean, I'm just knowing my knowledge of US Latin America, the State Department and US agencies are heavily involved in that. And the government, for the most part, has been kind of a client of the US. So I'm not surprised, but I just wondered what would account for, I mean, the shocking part of it to me is the fact that the peasants actually won it, the indigenous peoples actually won it at some point.
It's important, of course he was, because part of the calculation of Chevron's when they said in Texaco's when they wanted it sent back to Ecuador is because they thought the government would make it go away. And then when Correa came into power, that wasn't happening. Although it didn't stop Chevron from trying to get Ecuador's trade status revoked by the US government year after year after year. In fact, President Obama, when he was a senator, wrote a letter complaining about how Chevron was trying to go after trade status with Ecuador and using its pressure to try to undermine justice in this case. So that $19 billion judgment was shocking to the entire oil industry, right? 2011, what's happening here? Indigenous peoples managed to do this after all these, like how did they not make this case go away, right? An important note is that the judgment, half of it was a punitive judgment, not the damage assessment. So later on, the Ecuadorian Supreme Court said that punitive measure was not constitutional, which is why the judgment was halved to $9.5 billion. Chevron likes to spin that and say that, oh, even the court said that was too much money. That's why it was cut in half. It was ridiculous. BP's already paid $30 billion towards cleaning up the Deepwater Horizon spill. And it was much less and easier to clean than this, right? So $9.5 billion doesn't even come close. But the $9.5 billion was to remediate and to provide health costs for the communities that were suffering a massive health crisis. Cancer rates extremely high. At least 1,500 people at that point had already died from cancer and other related illnesses. It had literally wiped out entire communities. Okay, so. This was not about enriching the people of Ecuador. This was about paying to clean up their environment and help them because they were suffering.
And how large are the populations which were impacted by this crime, this ecological crime? And then two, how big is the area we're talking about?
So it's about 30,000 people that were in the affected area. It's about the size of Rhode Island. So pretty huge. And when you look, Ecuador is a very small country. It's an amazingly beautiful country because it has so many different environments within one small country. You've got the Amazon and the Andes and the tropics and the Galapagos and, this northern Ecuadorian Amazon region. And my family actually is from Ecuador. My cousins, my uncles there, they actually were big in the tourist industry. So the Amazon itself, especially at this time, was becoming a tourist destination and helping the economy of Ecuador for people who are coming to visit. But this part of the northern Ecuadorian Amazon was recognized as just destroyed. You can't send people there. It's just covered with toxic waste pits. And of course, the saga is that Ecuador is still trying to exploit the Amazon for oil and drilling in the southern Ecuadorian Amazon. And part of the reason that they haven't been able to do it as much as they've wanted to is the legacy of the destruction that they permitted in the northern Ecuadorian Amazon. So just to say really quickly, I remember in 92 when Texaco left, they handed over this system that they had maintained and built for decades to the Ecuadorian government. At that point, the Ecuadorian government and Petroecuador, which is the national oil company, which didn't exist when Texaco first arrived, took over operation. And they did continue to pollute with that system. In fact, the only way they couldn't have is if they didn't operate it, if they'd shut down the wells completely, which is what they should have done, but they didn't. So the argument of Texaco's and Chevron's that this is the responsibility of government Ecuador because they also polluted, there's validity to the fact that the Ecuadorian government polluted, but it doesn't absolve Chevron from the 1964 to 1992 billions of dollars. Like, they caused the deaths of thousands of people. Those people's deaths are not on the government's hands. They're on, well, to the extent that Chevron did it, the government should have, of course, held them to account, but that's a whole other discussion. Anyway, the case in 2011 comes out, and the entire time that it's winding down and Chevron knows ultimately there's going to be a judgment and knows that the evidence against it is completely overwhelming, they started to put into place a strategy to invalidate that judgment. They had long since pulled their assets out of Ecuador, right? So their calculation was, even if the Ecuadorian government says we owe $9.5 billion, good luck getting the money, right? We don't have any bank accounts in your country. And so the most nefarious part outside of deliberately poisoning people for decades, which is pretty horrific, was this, the legal strategy and the PR strategy to undercut the entire victory of the indigenous communities by invalidating it in the United States, which is Chevron's calculation of, if we can prevent them from ever bringing that judgment to the United States, they'll never get our money and ultimately we'll get away with the crime. So 2 weeks prior to that judgment on February 14th in 2011, Chevron filed RICO charges, civil RICO charges. RICO is an anti-racketeering law that was created in the 70s to go after the mafia, right? And so it argued that it was the victim of a global conspiracy to extort money for something that didn't happen in Ecuador. And so they convinced a New York trial judge, Lewis Kaplan, in that same district, Southern District of New York, to hear, in fact, truth be told, he actually recommended the RICO charges. They filed the RICO charges 2 weeks prior. And what's important to the prior part is that in a normal situation, if an Ecuadorian judgment was found, that the proper appeals process would happen in Ecuador. And once it reaches the ultimate level in that court system, then the Ecuadorians would bring that to the United States and Chevron would defend itself on the merits against this claim. But they didn't want that to happen. They had to make sure it didn't happen because the evidence was so overwhelming. So by preemptively filing these RICO charges, even before the verdict was started, they got a judge to allow them to have a trial in the United States, which specifically excluded the evidence of their contamination. That was not part of their RICO trial. And they did this based on footage that they got of a documentary made called Crude, which everybody should watch. Joe Berlinger was the director of it. And they got this judge to force Joe Berlinger to turn over all of his footage, all of the outtakes. They violated his First Amendment rights and they got access to information. And then they used it and they twisted and cut scenes to show to a judge to say there was fraud in this case. And their RICO claim was based on their allegation that Steven Donziger and the Ecuadorian lawyers who worked with him had ghostwritten the Ecuadorian judgment and that they had bribed a judge to accept their ghostwritten judgment instead of his own judgment. It doesn't pass the sniff test in the least from my point of view because the crime was super clear from day one and they admitted to the crime, right? The whole legal issue is just a matter of how much should Chevron pay to clean up if they were a consortium owner? And I would say 100% because they were the sole operator, right? If you guys decide to commit a crime together, but one of you gets a gun, gets a car, goes into a bank, robs the bank and leaves, just because you come back and say, hey, I'm going to share a $500 with you, that does not mean that you're the one who should go to jail. You know, it's you're the sole operator, you committed the crime. But so they argued that You know, they shouldn't have to even clean up all of it. The point of the RICO case was to say none of this was real, and to start to sow the seeds of doubt in the United States public and in the court system that this was all just a scheme of greedy lawyers from New York who wanted to exploit indigenous people in Ecuador and used what they called a corrupt judiciary to try to do that. And that narrative was super appealing to a certain population in the United States, and it worked. And worse than that, this judge, Lewis Kaplan, who allowed the RICO charges to be filed, he permitted Chevron to base its case on a witness who was bribed, who admitted that he lied, and who alleged that he ghostwrote the judgment, but offered no evidence to back up that claim. No judge in the world would have allowed this witness. And I, full disclosure, I went to the RICO trial. I was there in the courtroom for almost everything. I wasn't there for the Ecuadorian trial because I only started working with Amazon Watch in 2007. And we did have members of our team, Kevin Koenig, who were there. They accompanied through the entire process of the trial in Ecuador because we've worked on this case since 2000. But the RICO case hinged on the testimony of this man named Alberto Guerra. And Guerra had actually been one of those judges. Those, you know, how I told you they cycle out every 2 years. At one point, Guerra was one of them. Guerra had a relationship with Zambrano, who was the judge who ultimately wrote the judgment in 2011. And Guerra was approached by Chevron. Their lawyers met him. They offered him $18,000 in cash to buy his computer and say, and asked him for his story about what happened in the case. So Guerra said, and he admitted to this later, he told them, that's a good start. Money talks, but gold screams. Like, how much money you're going to give me for this story? And so he made up a story that Steven Donziger offered him a $500,000 bribe if he would ghostwrite the judgment and give it to Zambrano, and Zambrano would adopt it. And that it's based on that testimony that Chevron won in 2014, that RICO decision. By winning that decision, it blocked enforcement of the Ecuadorian judgment. And the fact that Guerra wasn't a credible witness was ignored by the appeals court that later upheld it. But worse, he admitted in another proceeding that he had specifically lied during the RICO case to get more money. Chevron paid him $2 million in cash and benefits. They bought him a house, a car, gave him a monthly stipend, moved his entire family to the United States, and got them all permanent resident visas. This is millions of dollars of benefits. And they all said, oh, this is just to protect Guerra. Meanwhile, he's a fact witness in a case, which is illegal, right? Of course you can't pay a fact witness. Imagine if you could offer people millions of dollars to testify and say what you wanted to say. They also coached him for 53 days and he still couldn't get his story right. It was completely unbelievable on the stand, which really exposed the bias and the level of corruption that was going on from the start in the RICO case. But regardless, the way the US system is set up, and Chevron knew this very well, if you can get a trial judge like Lewis Kaplan, who was in your corner, to allow these kinds of things to go forward and write a really massive judgment in your favor, then it's really hard to get anybody to knock that down. And Kaplan was overtly racist to the Ecuadorians. He was completely dismissive of the country. He would like talk during the trial about asking questions like, how much is the GDP of Ecuador anyway? And how much is Chevron worth? And so-called plaintiffs, I mean, it was disgusting.
He's a federal judge. Who was he appointed by?
He was appointed by Clinton. He used to work for the tobacco industry when he was a lawyer. So this is a very pro-corporate guy. And yeah, I mean, some people hear Democrat. And to be, it's funny because even some current members of Congress have asked when they're inquiring about this case, like, who appointed the judge? As if it was a Democrat, well, maybe he's okay. Like, yeah. No, come on. We all know what that means, right?
I mean, what you were just discussing, you know, in 2014, I mean, in order to do what they did, the Department of Justice, Department of State, and Immigration would have to be involved to get these people through to you know, fast track their immigration status. So, and this is, you know, in the Obama presidency. So it's kind of, you know, not feasible that people at very high levels were not aware and contributing to this. Just quick, now Donziger is the public face of this. Was he part of a law firm, or why him and no one else?
So, well, one reason is he was involved all the way from the beginning. So he was just not too long out of Harvard Law in 93 when he went down and started working on the case, but he wasn't a lead lawyer at the time. Although he became more and more important as the case moved forward in New York against Texaco. And then actually in the Ecuadorian decision, he's not a lawyer in Ecuador. So he wasn't in the courtroom arguing in Ecuadorian courts, but he was the driving force behind raising the funds to fund the lawsuit in Ecuador, and then strategy for litigation and enforcement actions afterwards, and keeping the momentum going behind this decades-long campaign. And what's the reason that he was drawn into it more is because he is what fit Chevron's narrative of this is a New York lawyer who's just trying to get rich and exploiting the situation. And trial, he features prominently in
thing around trial lawyers, targeting trial lawyers who are ambulance chasers, that sort of thing.
Well, the other different thing about Steven is that, you know, that I work in human rights, and we've worked with many organizations that are nonprofit organizations with human rights lawyers and environmental lawyers. That's not how this case was financed. This case was financed with the finance litigation strategy was actually selling off percentages in the ultimate judgment to fund the case. And arguably, that's the reason that Chevron was so scared, because it wasn't just a room full of pro bono nonprofit lawyers who could not afford to dedicate their entire lives to this case because it was going to go on forever, but because it had high-powered U.S. law firms involved as well. And so Chevron wanted to take down Donziger to prevent him from continuing to bring in this support. And in 2009, it's been found one of their internal emails said, our long-term strategy is to demonize Donziger. So just like the original pollution, there was no hiding the fact that that was what they were trying to do. The problem was that they got this judge to go along with them. And once you do that, the power, and maybe you've talked about this on your podcast before, but like the ridiculous amount of power control that a federal judge has, it's shocking. And the level of control, like you can't even get the judge recused because you have to ask that judge to recuse himself or herself. Yeah. So
I think so many people were shocked by the recent Rittenhouse case, who didn't realize that's kind of the way, that's just the way trials work. Or like Julian Assange is very similar, right? You have kind of something on it. And in all of these cases, not all of them, but not everybody on the left, but it's really hard to kind of get people. I've talked to some people about this, and the general idea impression I get is, well, Donziger must have done something wrong, because something this crazy couldn't happen. It's so far out there that he must have done something, you know. So,
well, it's funny because first of all, I think it's from watching too many TV shows about law, right? I mean, that's done it. But same thing with police. The biggest disservice to our perception of police and justice in the U.S. is TV shows that glorify all that stuff, is that they're all the good guys. Oh, my God.
That was our last episode that we just talked about. Copaganda.
Exactly. So when this case went through, at that point, it was clear to everybody outside the U.S., Texaco, Chevron did this horrible thing, and now they're using the U.S. judiciary to basically subvert justice, right? And they go back to their own courts who are going to help them. In the U.S., the narrative was perfectly sold by Chevron and their PR firms and the lawyers that, okay, this is Donziger's. Donziger's a criminal mastermind who orchestrated a global conspiracy over the course of decades. And it's amazing that they could all sell by himself. Like, it's all just made up. Like, what? Yeah. And we're sitting here looking at it, Amazon Watch, because we were mentioned as a non-party co-conspirator. So was Rainforest Action Network. They hit us with subpoenas and all this stuff, which they lost, because when you're not in front of a judge named Kaplan, Chevron doesn't win, right? But the point was, they got this RICO judgment, and that closed the door on the enforcement of the Ecuadorian judgment in the United States, because it determined that it was procured by fraud And Donziger had committed these committed fraud, but not criminal. This was, remember, civil RICO. So he was not charged with any crime, nor found guilty of a crime. He was found guilty of perpetrating a fraud against Chevron civilly. But that didn't stop the pursuit of justice in the case. And that's why we're still talking about it now. But Chevron couldn't take their win and just go home with it. They really did want to demonize and destroy Donziger. And so after they won that RICO verdict and the Supreme Court ultimately refused to hear it, they continued to pursue Donziger using it. And the real reason, in my estimation, is because the Ecuadorians continued to seek enforcement outside the United States. So they went to Canada and they brought that judgment to Canada, and the Canadian Supreme Court validated and said, you have the right to seek enforcement of this judgment in Canada, which really freaked out Chevron, because here's another northern country, right? So these are white judges who they actually care about as opposed to Ecuadorian judges. And they said, yeah, you can pursue it. And they wanted to prevent Donziger from getting that further along. And that's when they went back to Kaplan and said, Your Honor, he is violating your RICO decision. We need to get access to all his information, find out who's giving him money. He's not, because according to the decision, Stephen was not able to monetize or in any way benefit from the Ecuadorian judgment in the United States because it was quote unquote procured by fraud. So they used that strategy and they targeted the people that were working with Donziger and others to support enforcement outside of the United States. They would bring them in and depose them, force them to spend tons of money on lawyers to protect themselves from a collateral attack from Chevron's lawyers, Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher. And that's how they got to the point of literally criminalizing him. So at the same time this pursuit of justice was happening in Canada, they were continuing to try to stop him in the United States. And so Judge Kaplan ultimately issued orders saying Stephen had to turn over his passports, turn over his computer, his cell phone, his email, passwords, so that the court could give them to Chevron to make sure he wasn't violating the RICO judgment. And Stephen was like, no, you know, I'm not going to do that. One, it's violating the rights of my clients. Two, it's just an unethical thing for a lawyer to do. So there were other complicated things about it. Actually, Kaplan was very sloppy in the way he issued these orders, and some of them were contradicting prior orders. So Stephen really wasn't even able to comply with them all. So he said, I'm challenging all these orders. I'm going to go, the way he termed it, into voluntary contempt of court and appeal to a higher court and ask the Second Circuit Court of Appeals to look at these things and make a decision. If they decide that I need to turn over my computer and cell phone and email passwords, I will do that. But I'm not doing it now because I don't agree with Kaplan. Kaplan then decided, screw this, I'm not going to wait for that. And he decided to file criminal contempt of court charges against Donziger while he was appealing his civil orders, which is practically unheard of. And he went to the federal prosecutor in New York and said, I want you to bring up charges. And they said no. They declined two times. Now, they told him they didn't have the resources. This is probably the most well-funded federal prosecutor's office in the entire US. Like, that was clearly an excuse. They saw that there was nothing here. This is a petty misdemeanor, ridiculous charge, and it was being appealed. But that didn't stop Kaplan. His vendetta was pretty clear against Stephen. And so he used something called Rule 42, which is a really obscure rule, allowing a federal judge to appoint a private prosecutor when the state isn't available to prosecute contempt of court charges. And the idea, and I'm not a lawyer, but the best way I can explain it is the idea is that courts need to be able to enforce their own rules. So if a judge doesn't have any other recourse, he can find somebody who will hold somebody in contempt because they're not doing what he or she says they have to do. And there is some logic behind that. But if the argument here is, well, it's because there was not enough resources, then clearly this is just about punishing Stephen. It's not about actually getting justice. Regardless, to make matters worse, not only did he hire a private prosecutor, but this judge went out and found a law firm that had worked for Chevron only a couple years prior. And, you know, Scott, maybe you remember, but like when Chevron was coming after Amazon Watch and Ran and others, We, fortunately, Amazon Watch worked with Earth Rights International, and they were fantastic at defending us. But organizations were looking at pro bono law firms to come in and help them. In San Francisco, all these firms were like, oh, we can't help you. We've had Chevron as a client. There's a conflict of interest there, right? And in this case, he should never have been able to appoint Sword and Kissel, a Chevron-connected law firm, to prosecute Donziger. But he was allowed to do it.
Maybe you'll get to this eventually, but is Kaplan personally, I mean, what's his personal, I mean, is he a big investor in Chevron, or golfing with the CEO every weekend, married to his sister or something, or, you know?
He has mutual fund investments in Chevron, which he refused, he failed to disclose prior to the case. By the way, I didn't even mention this, but Kaplan assigned the case to his own court, which is a violation of the rules of the Southern District of New York. He also, and this really is kind of the first sign that somebody should have stood up and said, Kaplan cannot be involved in this case. Before the RICO trial ended, Kaplan issued a global injunction. And he, this lone trial judge in New York, pretended to say that no court in the world could respect the Ecuadorian judgment and it should be blocked everywhere, as if he were a god, right? He doesn't have the authority to do anything like that, but that was even prior to the trial. So to show you his bias on behalf of Chevron, he was willing to go out on a limb even back then. And it was quickly shut down by the Second Circuit Court of Appeals. And they said to him, you can't overstep your authority. You can make a decision that pertains to the US and that's it. But Kaplan's hatred of Donziger and the Ecuadorians was palpable in the courtroom. I mean, he couldn't stand that Steven was standing up to him. And the way Donziger fights is like somebody who's been fighting an oil company for decades, not like a lawyer who you just call up and say, hey, we have this case with this powerful company. And they come in and, you know, during lunch, they're having coffee with the same guys from the other side of the aisle because, hey, we're all chums in the same profession here. This is an activist lawyer who is fighting like an activist.
Which is also a bit of a misnomer on lawyers and judges and these things that we see in TV and film as well.
Yeah,
it's like the coyote and the sheepdog and the Warner Brothers cartoons. It's like once the clock rings, then, like, you know, they're going out for a beer after work or whatever.
Yeah. Right. Well, the point being, in this case, like, it was super clear from the very beginning that Kaplan wanted to take Donziger down. And, you know, the fact that he was allowing his court to be turned into a farce by permitting the testimony of a clearly corrupted witness just further cemented that point. And that's gone on because Steven has resisted every step of the way Chevron's RICO attack. And it really pissed them off. It pissed off Chevron, it pissed off their lawyers, and it pissed off Kaplan, especially when they started to pursue enforcement because they thought they'd won. And yet here they are in Canada arguing.
Is there something, you know, kind of thinking about it, is like, you know, this is like one of the worst environmental crimes in the we know of. This is one of the biggest settlements against an oil company that there is. And so is there also something to the idea that Chevron wants to set a precedent that we don't, you know, we don't want any more of this. We don't want Exxon to have any of this. We don't want Shell to have any of this.
Yes.
We want to set a precedent. We want to destroy, you know, the person who in many ways has become the face of this. We want to destroy his life to set an example to everyone else who would maybe attempt this.
They did set that precedent. I mean, that's the scary thing about this use of RICO specifically. I mean, ultimately, this suit against Steven Donziger and the Ecuadorians is a slap suit. Right there, and of course they had the benefit of getting a judge who played along with their bogus evidence, but it's a baseless claim that they were able to win and thereby shut down this challenge against them. And the day it was filed, the Citizens for Tort Reform, which is just basically a pro-corporate group in the US, said this is the new playbook to go after corporate gadflies in America. We can shut them down by hitting them with RICO, which has happened to Greenpeace and Friends of the Earth, The Stand, and so many other groups that are now, they're being hit with these RICO charges. It's all the same thing. That's why we joined this group, Protect the Protest, a coalition of NGOs standing together to try to prevent these slap attacks. It's right. Very much the new playbook, and it's scary.
Well, it's also in that region, generally the U.S. will go in and intervene, you know, when these kind of resources, oil, copper, like in Chile, Kennecott and Anaconda, or UFCO with land in Guatemala, lithium in Bolivia. So, you know, this is more kind of U.S. centric. They're directing the actions here, but it fits a long-term pattern, clearly. I know Scott wants to ask about the media, which I think is a really crucial part of this, but has he gotten any support from any, you know, politicians or the legal community, New York firms?
The thing that's what I was kind of getting to before was, you know, they had their win, right? Well, they won the RICO case. They won their appeal. Steven lost the appeal, and then the Supreme Court refused to hear it. At that point, Chevron had changed the narrative. As you said, some people were saying, well, he must have done something.
Yeah.
And that stretches all the way down into the environmental movement, right? Because people even, we're all have that bias growing up here and you know, what we've seen. So that has now changed. And that's what's hopeful about this case. Their hubris was so massive, and they couldn't just take that win. They wanted to keep on going till they silenced Donziger forever and shut him down. And then they created a monster in Kaplan that people are now looking at it and seeing the full context and going, wow, actually, how did this happen? Like, why would a judge go berserk and file these criminal contempt of court charges? I didn't finish telling you, and it's important to say, he picked the prosecutor, he brought the judge, he brought the charges against for criminal contempt. Then he picked the judge to hear the case, again, a violation of the rules, Judge Loretta Preska, Federalist Society judge. And she overheard the criminal contempt of court charge. It was a foregone conclusion. He was sentenced to the maximum 6 months in jail after being held on house arrest for 2 years. No lawyer had been held more than 90 days in contempt of court charges in their home in history. And he'd been held 2 years pre-trial, then convicted to 6 months. So it was super clear. Like, talk to any lawyer you know. Don't tell them the names, change the names. Tell them what happened in this case, and they will look at you like you are crazy. That does not happen in the United States. And that's what began to happen. So 68 Nobel laureates, 11 members of the House and 2 senators, Amnesty, all the largest environmental and human rights organizations, many of whom hadn't been involved in the case for a while because of, you know, what had happened in the RICO case, they started to get back involved again. And shareholders are bringing this up. It's now got a new life to it. The entire movement has reinvigorated itself around protecting Steven from this attack and then ultimately pushing for justice in the case, because now it's super clear that this is just Chevron's manipulation of the US judiciary to escape accountability for a crime. And what I hope people start to get is that all of these other fights that we are having with the fossil fuel industry now hinge upon our ability to hold Chevron to account in this case, because as you mentioned, it set the precedent for how they could escape it, but it can also set the precedent for how we hold them accountable. Even more so, in the climate change cases, these oil companies are not admitting to having deliberately destroyed our climate for a profit, but we still want to hold them account for having done it. In the Ecuador case, they had even admitted to the crime, and we haven't been able to hold them to account for doing it. So what hope have we? So if we don't rally behind Steven now and the Ecuadorians now, it's going to come back to hurt all of our cases, which is really what's starting to catch on. And so the press coverage has changed. The narrative has changed. It's about an oil company's vendetta against one lawyer and how it's used the U.S. judicial system to criminalize him and try to silence him. And that's going to come back to bite Chevron, and watch for the next shareholder meeting. It's going to be there. And members of Congress on October 27th, I think, or 28th, Rashida Tlaib if you haven't seen the clip, you've got to watch this clip of Rashida Tlaib going after Chevron CEO Mike Wirth, because he starts talking and she says, what are you going to do about the $50 billion that you owe to people around the world who your company has harmed, including the people of Ecuador? He's like, what are you talking about? I don't really know. You got totally stammered. And she's like, you you can't criminalize all of us. Like, we know you did that to Steven Donziger. You cannot arrest us all. You cannot arrest the truth. We know what's going on here. And that was shocking to him. They did not expect to hear that, especially from Congress. So the narrative has changed, and I'm really hopeful that we can do more with it, but I'm also very concerned that we can't let this opportunity go. We as a movement, we can't let this opportunity go to push back against what's happened here, because now's the time. Like, the iron is hot, and yeah. Chevron has really dug its own grave.
Have any of the groups in Ecuador who were deprived of settlement gone to like international courts, the WTO, UN, anything like that?
Yeah, in fact, there was a complaint filed against the former CEO of Chevron, John Watson, at the International Criminal Court. Pablo Fajardo, one of the lead Ecuadorian lawyer in the case there, filed it, but it hasn't gone anywhere. There have been, and I'm sure there will continue to be, cases brought against Chevron globally. In fact, this report, chevronsglobaldestruction.com, I think if you Google it, you'll find it, just came out, which details cases in multiple countries of Chevron being involved in environmental destruction, torture, rape, disappearances, genocide, ecocide, that it owes over $50 billion in outstanding to communities that it has harmed. That's now in the congressional record. And I fully expect that to be raised at their next shareholder meeting, because this is kind of like kicked open the door to, oh, what is actually behind all of this legal strategy of Chevron's in this Ecuador case? It's not isolated. They do the same thing in Nigeria, in Burma, in Argentina, in Australia, and other places where they operate. And that's what's coming back sort of into the narrative about what this oil company is really about. And that's ultimately, my hope, going to be their undoing.
Real quick, just on my media question, is where we like sort of seen the narrative shift, particularly since this, you know, most recent of these stories over the last year or two around Steven. I'm kind of curious though that I've seen this from Steven's social media feed, is that there's like a lot of critique, like the New York Times in particular, some of the articles almost seems to like repeat Chevron's talking points verbatim. Then I've also seen that, you know, also talking about conflict of interest with lawyers, is that like some of Chevron's lawyers also represent the New York Times.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if you could just comment on that as well. It's like,
yeah,
how complicit is like mainstream media, particularly the gray lady, with big oil, particularly Chevron?
Yeah, it's super depressing because really there's just pervasive racism essentially in the coverage of this case. And one important point is when it's written about by corporate media, almost always will they say the alleged contamination, or Donziger alleged that Texaco did this thing or Chevron did this thing. There's no dispute by Texaco that they did it in the first place. They're totally covering their ass and just giving the benefit of the doubt to Chevron even after it admitted to this crime. And I've spent time challenging reporters who have written articles that way. Bloomberg is a perfect example. I wrote back to them after they published one article and I just said, look, you need to be aware when you write alleged contamination, you're casting doubt on whether it exists. It's an indisputable fact and Chevron doesn't dispute it. And I provided them evidence of where Chevron accepted that it happened and that they did it. And the response is basically, the editor writes back and said, yeah, we got your message. We're not changing the story. And after the RICO case came out, Amazon Watch had been working on a story with one of the three big networks, right? And it was supposed to come out that day talking about these leaked videos that have been sent to Amazon Watch showing Chevron technicians finding contamination during the course of the trial in Ecuador in well sites that they had claimed to have remediated. So even the portion that they said they cleaned up, they couldn't find clean. So somebody sent us these videos, leaked videos. And
I remember this.
Yeah, we called them the Chevron tapes, and it was ultimately put out by Vice News. But one of the main networks, and I can't say which, was gonna run a story. And the morning of the story, the reporter called me and said, my editor is making me kill the entire story. And he said, look, off the record, there's a total smear campaign against you. They're using this RICO case and they won't let us publish anything about it, even though these were independently verifiable. And that has continued on. So if they can't get an editor to cut the story, then they intimidate the journalist or they smear them in another publication. And in the case of the New York Times, Ted Boutros, who has built a reputation as his First Amendment hero. He's a lawyer, a principal lawyer at Gibson, Dunn and Crutcher. He represents the New York Times and CNN. And the New York Times, the entire time Donziger was in home confinement, refused to run a single story about it. So the Nobel laureates got involved, Congress got involved, Senate got involved, all these things that were happening. 2 miles down the road from their main office, here's this guy who's been in an unprecedented situation, and the New York Times couldn't spare 2 lines about it. And then we found out that one of the New York Times writers, a magazine writer, William Languishy, who had written an amazing article in Vanity Fair back in 2007, I think, had been working for months on a piece about the case. And he went to Donziger's bar hearing, because I didn't even mention this, but they got his license revoked, right?
Yeah.
I met with William at the bar hearing. He had been working for a piece for months. The editors killed the story. And they don't have to tell you why, but we all know the reason why, right? And then it became, we're gonna have to rely on The Intercepts, on Common Dreams, on, you know, Democracy Now, right, and the non-corporate media to get that story out there. And it wasn't until Donziger was already sent to prison that CNN finally ran a 2-minute piece, and the New York Times ran a little article, and MSNBC ran one segment. And that's it. It still hasn't been a bigger story, and yet it involves the largest oil-related environmental crime in history. So it's totally discouraging, but at this point, there's only so much they can do to beat back the story, right? Somebody is gonna be like, hey, look, this story is interesting. People want to know about it. It's going to start getting into even the corporate media. And I think ultimately, again, their efforts to demonize Steven and crush him are going to mean that someone's going to actually need to start writing the story. So, but they still do, they will handle it in the racist manner that they do, which is essentially saying one white judge in New York has a more important opinion than every appellate judge in Ecuador, right? Because it went through the Ecuadorian local court, Supreme Court, Constitutional Court, 19 different judges in Ecuador all looked at Chevron's allegations and decided for the Ecuadorians and said that their fraud allegations were false. But the only one that's printed up in an article by corporate media is Judge Lewis Kaplan and his opinion. And that's going to continue, unfortunately, because of the you know, inherent racism in the way this stuff is reported.
I know you only have a few minutes left. I have two questions, one which might be a long question. I don't know if Bob has any other questions.
No, I'm good. Yeah.
I want to ask a question about actually just some of the organizing, but I'm just kind of curious if you could, like, you know, just briefly touch on is how does this fit into like a larger, you know, conversation around like empire and extractivism, et cetera? Is that like we see these, you know, all powerful oil companies in the North getting away with this sort of things in the global South. I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts on that.
Yeah, well, in one sense, it's helpful for those of us who are fighting back against that because it provides a good example of what strategies these oil companies are going to take to try to silence and suppress the rights of the people that they've harmed. And it also could serve as a way to prevent that because it's such a clear case of wrongdoing by an oil company in the first place, right? It's not even debatable really when you look at the evidence versus some other things that may be more debatable, even though I believe that Chevron is responsible for destroying our climate and Exxon intentionally. They could make an argument to somebody in the middle of the road who'd be like, well, you know, are they solely responsible? In this case, solely responsible, right? So if we use this as an example to educate people on where our movement is vulnerable to attack and where the strategies that oil companies can and will apply are strongest and weakest, then maybe we can try to prevent some of them before they happen. There's been loopholes or things about the US law that have been exposed during the course of this. And what we really need is everyone in their own particular niche to take on aspects of that and work to combat it. So for example, Law Students for Climate Accountability created a campaign to boycott Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher. This is not their only case of doing this, right? They have what's called the kill step. That is their mechanism to invalidate foreign judgments in the United States. It's not just Chevron in this one case. So let's let the law students and those who advocate for ethics within the legal community use this as an example of how to vilify and take down firms that would proceed in these unethical manner. And then on the other side, there's international relations, right? And how does the US Congress feel about our judicial system being used to block the right to justice for indigenous peoples and basically people of color who've been harmed by a US oil company? Jim McGovern, a representative from Massachusetts, said it really well. He's like, I'm so embarrassed that a US oil company was able to do this and nobody in the United States has held them to account. In fact, we've helped them get away with the crime. So what mechanisms can be put into place to address this more even diplomatically if the courts are not going to ultimately allow justice to be served? And that's, again, another advocacy role or role that could be taken up by certain elements in our movement. The precedent of drilling for oil in the Amazon, which even if Chevron had behaved impeccably, even if it had tried to do its best, would have created massive destruction, environmental destruction, destruction of indigenous lives, as it is continuing to do when other companies go. That is now starting, we're seeing the needle move back in the right direction. And it's because of not only this case, but the financing behind these types, this type of extraction is going away. So we've successfully, when I say we, like, not just Amazon Watch, but other organizations working with us and Stand.Earth and the work that RAND does have been targeting the money behind these companies. And when you point to this case, if you're now able to point to it as not only a victory, but an ethical case of a clear crime that was committed and justice, you know, being sought, then it will advance that forward rather than before, where it was, well, we have to be skeptical of these indigenous communities and their lawyers because they might try what they tried in the Chevron case. You know, so that's why I just see it as so critical. It's a linchpin basically for corporate accountability, environmental justice, the climate justice movement, judicial reform in the United States, the US imperialist attitude towards Latin America, and the extractive industry in the region. You know, not just the Amazon, but of course that's principally what we're talking about here. And I guess I would say I'm hopeful because I know that there are people out there now looking at aspects of that who are interested in doing more on it. And it's because of the work that we haven't given up, and the Ecuadorian people haven't given up, despite the fact that so many have died. And it's literally a generational fight for the people that were harmed.
Well, you answered my question around organizing, because I was going to specifically talk about the law students organizing to boycott Gibson and Dunn. But, you know, you had referenced earlier that there was organizing. It's like kind of breathe new life into organizing around Chevron, et cetera. You want to just throw out a couple of things that people can find out? And this episode will probably be dropping on Monday. And I know that there's an action
for December 21st
in the Bay Area in Richmond, the Chevron refinery.
That's right. I don't know. I think it's led by I Don't Know More, SF Bay, and it's on the winter solstice. So there will be an action at the refinery. You know, we talk about what happened in Ecuador, of course, because of how horrific it is. But right down the street in Richmond, you know, Chevron is poisoning communities of color daily. In fact, there was a Guardian article today about how the evidence that it's your race and ethnicity that affects most, first and foremost, whether you are suffering from pollution, even over wealth in the United States. So communities of color in Richmond are being harmed by Chevron today. And it's, as I mentioned before, it's a practice that they've continued globally. So every year now on May 21st is something that we call Anti-Chevron Day. It started in 2014. And in the first year, there were 20 different countries that participated. And so every year, about a week to 10 days prior to their shareholder meeting, this global day of action focusing on Chevron's crimes happens, called Anti-Chevron Day. And out of that, more and more groups have built their own campaigns focusing on what Chevron is doing and trying to explain not only why they need to be held to account, but how they're essentially the poster child for everything that's wrong with the fossil fuel industry. There's so many different websites, I don't even know where to start, but if you start Googling Chevron, the best way to start is actually looking at images, because they buy Google AdWords. So as soon as you Google Chevron Ecuador, you're gonna find five websites that are all their fake websites. They've created fake news sites in Richmond, California. They've created fake Amazon blogs to promote their lies about what happened there. But if you can sift past that, you will find a variety of new sites and groups that have come forward. Even that group that I mentioned, Protect the Protest, we started a new campaign essentially called License to Spill, pointing out that Chevron has basically built its own ability to pollute with impunity, and that's a standard, it's not an exception. And there's, you know, I hope there will continue to be more of it, but that movement has gained real strength. And I think at the shareholder meeting, Chevron is still headquartered in San Ramon, and every year they have a shareholder meeting there, or sometimes they have it in Midland, Texas. You will see representatives from communities all around the world that are targeted by Chevron, harmed by Chevron, fighting back. And we didn't even mention Burma and Myanmar and their support for the military junta there and the atrocities. But you know, that's obviously a huge crime that Chevron has blood on its hands for.
Thank you so much. Hopefully we'll get you back. We'd love to have Steven on as well. I think this is a story that many of people in our community have ignored, or they're not aware of it, or they've kind of dismissed it. And I think things like this, or the Assange case, are really critical. You know, these kind of very fundamental issues of free expression and corporate power or state power. So we really do appreciate it.
Thank you
for an update. And
much thanks for coming on today.
Good luck.
Yeah, I'm sorry that it kind of takes so long to explain. As I like to say, like, that's by design, right? Chevron wants it to be so hard, because then people will go like, oh my God, I don't have time to figure all this thing out. And they move on to the next thing. But
we have episodes that we call our deep background episodes. And so we've done a few on, most recently we did a bunch on Afghanistan, for example. And so, you know, awesome. This is really informative and useful for folks out there. Folks, you've been listening to Paul Pazaminio with Amazon Watch, talking about Chevron, Ecuador, the Steven Donziger case. You're listening to the Green and Red podcast. You can check us out on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. Hit that subscribe button if you're watching this on YouTube. And if you want to donate, check us out at greenandredpodcast.org and hit the support button, or become a recurring donor at patreon.com/greenredpodcast. Everyone out there, take care, stay safe. If you're in the Bay Area, come join us Tuesday morning out at the Richmond Refinery. And just in general, go misbehave.
Yeah.
When Chevron came to Ecuador, it was Texaco back then. They did there what they did so many times again. Ocean of sludge stored in pits unlined, no stone unturned, no resources unmined. They call it the Chernobyl of the Amazon. 1,000 square miles, dead and gone. When Chevron came to Ecuador, it was a dictatorship there. What happened in the Amazon, they didn't care. As long as they made money, let the oil flow where the waste went. No one wanted to know, and if they did, they could be bought. And if not, they could be abducted, tortured, and shot. When Chevron came to Ecuador, the location was preferred by the oil corporation. Because they had free reign, there was no oversight. And if anyone complained, then one night they'd not be seen again. It was a torture state. This was why Chevron thought it was so great. When Chevron came to Ecuador, it was paradise on earth. They turned it into a land of stillbirth. They left behind the ruins and took all the loot. Now they're trying to silence the ones who brought the lawsuit. Why was Donziger detained? A corrupt judge knows. And where are all the billions that the company owes? When Chevron came to Ecuador. When Chevron came to Ecuador.